Hey guys, my name's Hunter T. Wilson, aka Texas Pipeliner 35, and I'm one of the newest hosts for Weld.com. Today, we'll be headed to Orange Grove, Texas to go set a 4-inch short neck bell nipple. Y'all stick around and watch this, it's gonna be awesome. First things first, what we want to do is we want to cover the rat hole. Helpers love falling in rat holes for whatever reason. We don't want that today because we don't want to hear them crying about it. All right, guys. So what this bell nipple is used for is we're going to put it on this piece of casing here, which is an oil well. And they're going to put what's called a 4.5-inch independent head on top of this so they can control the flow, hook up their hairpin, hook up the tank battery, all that fun stuff. But first things first, we need to get our cut, our final cut. So this ugly cut right here is called our rough cut. We need to get our final cut on here, which has to be straight, clean, and nice. And then we have to hand bevel it to match the bevel on the inside so we get a good seal inside this bell nipple. Once we do that, we can start welding. But first, let's start with the prep. We found where our cut's gonna be. And this line right here is where I want my weld to be. So my weld's gonna be sitting about right there. So I don't have a whole lot of space to weld this, but we'll get it done. It'll be all right, trust me. So usually the gas company will give you a measurement of where they want you to have this thing cut. In this instance, the customer did not give me a specified measurement. They said, put it as low as you possibly can and still be able to weld it. So that's what we're doing today. I'm leaving myself a little bit of comfort room here. So that way I can make a nice, good, clean weld. So with this, I'm gonna start with a 1/4-inch grinding wheel. And what I wanna do is I wanna knock everything down, get everything level and square, and get my face where I want it. As you're gonna see here in a second, I'm gonna start working that bevel into it because I can take a lot more metal off with this 1/4-inch wheel than I can with a tiger disc. But when I'm done with this, I'm gonna go clean that bevel up with a tiger paw, get it nice and polished and clean looking. Because even though no one's gonna see it, it makes me feel better. It's not super important to hit it with a tiger disc, but it's just something I prefer to do. We got the outside ground and tiger disc looking the way we want it. So we're gonna clean the inside here, get any burrs, dross, anything on the inside knocked out, get it smoothed out. And as soon as I'm done with this, I'm gonna hit it again with the tiger paw on top. Good seat when we put that bell nipple on. All right, so we got our casing cut, prepped, beveled, everything nice and neat. So all we're gonna do now is slide this thing on just like that. Perfect, it's right where we want it. So now what I'm gonna have to do is I'm gonna have to do 70/18 all the way out on the outside here as per the customer's procedure and requests. And then on the inside, we're gonna back weld it with 60/10. That back weld is really important on a fitting like this because whenever you got fluid coming up, over time, even though we got a good tight seal on the inside here, fluid will still find a way to seep into these walls. And over time, what that'll do is it'll eat out these walls, eat out the weld, and then we'll end up having a blowout. So a lot of people think that you don't have to back weld these things, but it's super important that you do.
What's going on, everyone? Austin Harga here, AKA Dr. Welds. I'm doing a product spotlight for Weld.com on Meridian Labs rotary grounds. These things are robust industrial design made for long lasting performance. They provide low stable resistance for high current applications. We're gonna put it through the ringer today on this rollout machine. I'm gonna heli-arc this pipe all the way out, root to cap. Let's get to it.
You
These grounds are super durable, super robust. They've been tested as far as how many times it can spin, over 500 million times that thing can spin and still not have any effects. It also has been tested with lightning strikes up to 100,000 amps. So this thing can handle anything that you throw at it. It can spin as many times as you want it. It's gonna outwork you just like it's outworking me today. So we're gonna put a lid on it and finish this thing up. Long lasting performance, unaffected by number of revolutions and the speed in which the pipe rolls. This thing's gonna outwork you every time. Use these for rotary welding, electroplating, cable reels, electro polishing, plasma cutting. It's got a lot of applications. Don't forget to check out Weld.com, sign up for the app. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and follow. Till next time.
Before we get started, let's talk machine settings. So my fine current and my coarse current. So these are gears. So when I say I'm in third gear, I'm 120 to 190. On this side, I'm just gonna stay on zero, but whenever you're helping a welder or you get your own machine like this, everything's in increments of five, starting from 10 to 100. So if I ever tell my helper up five, then it's halfway. But for what we're doing, this is gonna stay right here. Everything's off of our remote box. So, you know, up five right there, up 10 right there. For what I'm gonna be doing with my 7018, I'm gonna be between 35 and 30. So my first pass is gonna be 35, then I'm gonna drop down five for my two bead cap so I can kind of try and make it look nice. Then for my 6010, I'm gonna stay about 55, 60, depending on how it's laying in there. But I'm gonna start off right here at 55. Let's get after it. We gave it three good tacks on the outside, all 7018. So everything on the outside is 7018 from root to cap. That's the way the customer wants it. That's the way it's written in their procedure. So that's what we're doing. We're running the machine third gear in 35 with a 3/32 7018 rod. And it's kind of hard to see it from the arc shots, but we're really low to the ground and it's an overhead weld. It's not exactly the easiest thing in the world. It's not difficult, it's just annoying because we have these wings on this hammer union that's getting in our way and just making things more and more difficult for us as we go around and our rod gets shorter. You're gonna have a lot of stops and restarts with this because all of this was done with me laying down and moving around this casing. I'm just having to stop and restart a lot. I'll typically run until my rod gets to a pushing angle instead of a drag angle. And that's where I'll stop before I start pushing with my puddle because that's when I'll start catching trash and porosity in the weld that we really don't want in there. Especially being this first pass is going to be the most important one because it's what's sealing everything up. So as I'm doing this, I'm doing a real fast up and down motion and pausing a little bit longer on top than I am on bottom. And I'm just watching that puddle fuse in and then I'm going to move up, down, fuse on top, move down, fuse on bottom, move up. And I'm just going to do that all the way around. So whenever I restart this rod, I'm gonna strike it and drag back and get it lit, get it hot. Then I'm gonna come back to where I left off, do two fast circles and keep going with the same pattern that I had going. Pausing on top for a little bit longer, watching it fuse in, go down to the bottom, watch it fuse in, move up, and just keep on and on with that. So whenever I start this, I'm gonna turn my machine up to 55 on the remote box, still in third gear. And I'm gonna weld this with 6010 so I can get in there a little bit flusher with it. So as you can see, before I started, I have a slight bend in my rod. What that allows me to do is it allows me to get that rod in there a little more on with it instead of pointing straight down with it. If I point straight down with it, what's gonna happen is that weld's gonna wanna roll over and make a belly. And then for sure, we're gonna have to do a lot of grinding on the inside. As I'm going around this bell nipple on the inside, I'm taking really fast, short steps to make sure that
it's sealing, but I'm not overdoing it. You can see here I'm bending my rod again, making sure I can get in there a little bit straighter on with it. Now, the other thing I'm gonna do, whenever I get back to where I originally started this weld, instead of coming into it, doing two circles to build up a nice button and pull out, I'm gonna come into it, come past it a little bit, about quarter inch, eighth of an inch or so, and I'm just gonna come straight out. So that way it leaves it a little low. So this is the outside of it. It doesn't look slick, but we know it's clean, we know it's good. And for what it is, it doesn't have to be pretty, as long as we know that it's a good, clean, solid weld all the way around. Well guys, that's all there is to welding a bell nipple. It's a super simple socket weld and a very important one at that. But my name's Hunter T. Wilson. If y'all ever want to get a hold of me, you can hit me up on Instagram at TexasPipeliner35 or on TikTok as Professor_Wilson. And make sure to check out the Weld.com app. You can also hit me up there as TexasPipeliner35. We're done with this one, guys. We're on to the next one, and I'll see y'all down the line.